Okay, thank you. First, thank you, Hans and Bruno, for inviting me. And thank you to Jean-Claude for sharing this presentation with me. So I'm very glad to be here tonight, not only to celebrate 30 years of wavelets or to enjoy the tonight bouillabaisse, but because it's a wonderful opportunity for me to meet again old colleagues and old friends that I haven't met for years. And actually this meeting that projected me 30 years ago when we were here in Marseille, a group of mainly young scientists coming from different disciplines, mathematics, physics, acoustics, signal processing, computer music, and we were all here sharing information, collaborating all together on various projects related to wavelets. And that was a wonderful moment. And now I really realize how fortunate I was to be able to live such a scientific experience and also such a human experience. And such a very special experience wouldn't have been possible without a very special man. And since Alex is here today, Alex Kosman, I would like, Alex, once again, to thank you for, what can I say, for being what you are. Thank you, Alex. So, now, let's go back to sound, music, and wavelets in Marseille. So, I'm supposed to give a report on what happened in Marseille 30 years ago. So I'm not sure it's a good sign when you are asked to give a historical report. But what to do? Time is flying, and I cannot deny that for me this story started in 85. But if I have enough time, I hope, depending on the chairman, I will talk also about the current challenge in sound and music. So, as I said, for me, this story started in 85. At that time, I was a young researcher. Of course, I had no fixed job, but I was very active in research anyway. And I was just starting a new research project linked to what we call analysis synthesis. And the idea here was to develop techniques so that we could resynthesize the sounds from the analysis of a natural one. But of course, the idea was not only to be able to resynthesize a sound, which is identical to the original, but the idea was to be able to make sound transformations by altering the representation between the analysis and the synthesis processes. Another issue related to analysis synthesis relates to what we call parameter estimation. And here the idea was to be able to estimate parameters corresponding to a given sound synthesis model. So that was a very challenging program, which raised mainly two issues. First, how to represent non-stationary signals in a way which is convenient for such a problem, for sound signals. And second, how to take into account human perception, because we should never forget that sounds are supposed to be heard at the end. So Jean-Claude was aware of my project, of course, and one day he came, but you know the story because Jean-Claude already told you. He came and told me, well, I know Alex Grossman at the Centre de Physique Théorique in Marseille, and I know he is currently working on a new method for not sound, but signal decomposition, and this method should be of interest for you. Okay, so Jean-Claude introduced me to Alex, and this is definitely because of them that you have to listen to me now. So, I met Alex. That was like magic. It was, for me, unreal. Alex was talking about group theories, mathematics, and I was talking about sound music. But at the end, that was wonderful. We finally understood each other, and we started a long story, I would say. So I came back home with two papers. One paper from Goupillot, Grossman, and Morley, related to geophysics, and one paper from Grossman and Morley, related to the mathematics behind the wavelet transform. So it was not that easy, but after reading this paper, I concluded that wavelet transform should be of great interest for computer music, let's say. Because of what? Because first of the flexibility in the choice of the analyzing wavelet, which would open new way of analyzing signals, and because the analysis performed by the wavelet transform corresponded to an analysis with delta omega over omega equal constant. And this is very important because it's very close to what we call auditory models. So at that time, as Jean-Claude said, we had at the lab a wonderful system, which was SYTER for system temps réel, which was designed by Jean-François Louis for sound synthesis purposes, and which consisted in two parts, a piece of hardware with a signal processor specially designed for sound synthesis, and a host processor, which was a PDP 1123. So you can see the PDP here. It's not a washing machine, it's a real computer. And it was one of the best at that time. So Jean Morley was really interested in the possibility offered by this system, and we started collaborating. And he very often came at the lab in summer 86. It was 86. And so it was not easy to program, because this kind of machine, you had to program it at a very basic level, you know, assembling programming. But after some time, we succeeded in developing a software allowing to calculate the wavelet transform. And then we started investigating the possibility offered by the wavelet transform. So we made a movie. It's a 40-minute movie. Are you ready for? No, don't worry. I won't play it now. But I would like to play a small excerpt of this movie showing how it was possible to control the SYTER processor to calculate the wavelets. It's a just historical thing.
The parameters of the transform can be input with the help of a mouse that moves around the settings. Now we modify the input level. Now we change the total number of voices. Here we give the number of voices per octave. And finally, we specify the initial value of the dilation parameter. Let us now look at the result.
Yes, let's have a look at the results. So maybe you can recognize music from Jean-Claude Risset, and of course Alex was commenting the movie. So we analyzed a lot of sounds, and here is an example that I love this one because it's like a castle, you know. This is the wavelet transform of a signal which is nothing at the beginning. Then it starts like a sinusoid at frequency F, and then after one period we add a second component at frequency 2F, and then after two periods we add a third component at frequency 4F. So while this is not here, you can see both the modulus and the phase of the wavelet transform, and you can see the very nice characteristic features of the wavelet transform, its ability to detect singularities in the signal. Here, singularities are just discontinuities of the first derivative, and you can see also the nice behavior of the phase, which eventually allowed us to estimate what we call instantaneous frequencies. I also investigated what could be done by changing the wavelet. And here you can see on this picture the wavelet transform of a sound which corresponds to this score. This picture was taken as a cover for an issue of a computer music journal. And for that, the problem was, is it possible to detect interval of octaves? And for that, I just used a wavelet corresponding to two bumps in the frequency domains. So the oscillating part of the wavelet is a sum of two exponential with a frequency ratio of two. And this wavelet is well adapted to the detection of octave. And actually, you can see that when octaves are played, you can see a very specific pattern in the wavelet transform with a maximum of energy in the center of this pattern. Well, now let's go to sound processing. We wanted to make sound modification, but very quickly it was necessary to be able to calculate wavelet transform on very long signal, typically musical signal. So thanks to collaboration with Matthias Hochschneider, Jean Morlet and Philippe Chamichan, we developed a fast wavelet algorithm based on hierarchical decomposition of the wavelets. And thanks to this algorithm, it became possible to analyze, not in real time, but almost in real time, very long signals. So now the problem for sound processing is, can we change the sound by altering the representation between the analysis and the resynthesis processes? So for example, I want to add something in the sound. For example, I want to change the picture like that. So can I do that? But the answer is generally no, because when you modify the picture, the wavelet transform, you can guarantee that this new picture still belongs to the right space. And this is due to the fact that these pictures must satisfy constraints due to the reproducing kernels. So it was new for me, reproducing kernel. I'm not a mathematician. So Alex explained this concept to me, and thanks to a nice collaboration, I was able to make some transformation and to understand what was possible, what was not possible, and what could be done. So I will play for you now the very first example, some example of sound transformation using the wavelet transform. So I published this example in a sound sheet accompanying an article in the Computer Music Journal in 1988. So I will play that for you. Of course, it's far from being perfect, but that was the first example. It's kind of historical. So let's start with signal corresponding to voice signal. So I first play the original. You will hear the every sound will be played twice. So first, let's start with the original.
Tic, et il parla alors d'une voix étrange. Tic, et il parla alors d'une voix étrange.
Now, an example of a slowdown effect obtained by dilating the wavelet transform. But of course, when you delete the wavelet transform, you have to take care of the phase, because the idea is to keep what we call the formant at the same place. Otherwise, you change the vowels and the message. So the dilation is the slowdown effect is with a ratio of three.
Tic, et il parla alors une voix étrange. Tic, et il parla alors une voix étrange.
So same effect with an acceleration now.
Tic, et il parla alors une voix étrange. Tic, et il parla alors une voix étrange.
An interesting sound processing for musical application, for example, is what we call cross-synthesis. It consists in making hybridization of two sounds. And here I will play a real tremble sound and the cross synthesis obtained by taking the phases of the representation of the trombone and the modulus of the representation of the voice. So let's start with the trombone. Now the cross synthesis. One can do the same with a periodic sound, like this synthetic sound. In that case, you obtain something which is like a robotic voice. It's also possible to make sound transformation of on musical sounds. This is the original sound corresponding to a saxophone. Here is a transposition effect without altering the duration of the signal. And now a slowdown effect. And of course, it's possible also to make more subtle transformation like this brightness effect, which is obtained by distorting the phase representation of the sound. So I play the original ones because so that you can hear the difference. And now the brightness effect obtained by distorting the phase. Okay, so another important problem related to sound synthesis, analysis synthesis, as I said at the beginning, is the estimation of parameters corresponding to a sound synthesis model. So I don't have enough time to go into details for that, but I would like just to take an example. Jean-Claude Risset talked about additive synthesis, and here the idea is to construct a sound by summing up elementary contributions that are sinusoid modulated in both amplitude and frequency. And then the game, of course, is to estimate from the analysis of a real sound both the amplitude and frequency modulation law of the component. So one could think that by looking at the restriction of a wavelet transform for a fixed value of the dilation parameter, we could get an estimation of the amplitude and frequency modulation law. But this is not true. What we get is a very poor estimation of this law. And this is because wavelet transform doesn't aim at separating the component. So how to go from this poor representation estimation to this nice one? So we developed a lot of techniques for that. So I don't have a lot of time, so I just we'll talk a bit about a technique based on what we call the ridges and the skeleton of this transform, which was the result of a very nice collaboration with Nathalie Delprat, Bernard Escudier, Philippe Guillemin, Philippe Chamichan, and Bruno Torrizani. And the idea here was to find in the time frequency, in the time scale domain, special points where most of the information contained in the signal is concentrated. And this point define trajectories, as you can see here in yellow. And these trajectories that we call skeleton, we have shown that by looking at the restriction of the wavelet transform along this trajectory, you get a very good estimation of both the amplitude and frequency modulation laws. Here, for example, this picture corresponds to the vibration of a piano string, and you can see a packet of energy. And it's interesting to see that this skeleton, these curves are more and more horizontal. This is due to the dispersion phenomena during the wave propagation. So I stop now with history. May I talk about future for 5 minutes? Okay. Just as a very short conclusion, I don't play the sound. I would say that thanks to this wonderful collaboration we had here in Marseille within the group driven by Alex, we could develop new method for analysis, synthesis, and transformation of sounds. But it is also worth noticing that most of these methods go beyond the scope of sound and music, and most of them have been used in very different contexts and applications. So, as always, science and research are never-ending stories. And, of course, making a new development arise new challenges. And among them, I would like to talk about the crucial issue of aiming at better understanding the relationship between low-level parameters and perceptual and even cognitive attributes. So actually, all the methods I presented, in all this method, I was manipulating very low-level parameters, such amplitude, frequency, phases of the wavelet transform. And it is not clear what is the relationship between this manipulation of low-level parameter and the actual perception of sounds. So the problem is how to perceptually control the sound. So this problem consists in two main challenges. First, how to control the evocation induced by sounds. For example, you listen to a sound, you like it or you don't like it, whatever, and you would like to transform it so that it sounds more metallic. How could you do that? That is a question. And another question is how to synthesize auditory scenes from a semantic description. For example, I would like to generate the sounds produced by a big wooden keg full of wine, rolling on gravels, for example. Is it possible to control the synthesis process from this description? To do that, it's important, and we have to integrate into the sound representation what we call sound semiotics. And in order to help you to understand how this can be done, I will play three very short sounds, and I ask you to focus on the material which constitute all the objects that are responsible to these sounds. First one. Second one. And third one. Okay, this sound is very different. If you look at the wavelet transform of this sound, you would see three different pictures. But I'm sure you all recognize the fact that all the objects were made with metal. So that means that we can make the hypothesis that it exists some invariants that are hidden somewhere in the signal and which are responsible to the fact that you recognize metal. So this hypothesis is inspired by the ecological approach of perception proposed by Gibson in 66 in the context of vision. And actually now we know that it exists two main kinds of sound invariants, transformational invariants that are responsible to the recognition of the action, and structural invariants that are responsible to the recognition of the object. And this hypothesis led to a new paradigm for sound synthesis, which is based on what we call action object, and we consist now in considering the sound as the result of an action on an object. And thanks to this paradigm, it's very easy to describe sounds and even to control sound synthesis system. For example, if you listen to this sound, it's you understand that this sound was produced by rubbing something, let's say a plate, and it was metallic. But we can also describe some metaphors, for example, the sound corresponding to the action of rubbing the wind. Or the sounds corresponding to a bouncing drop of water. Okay, so we worked a lot these last years at the Laboratoire de Mécanique et d'Acoustique on this paradigm, and we eventually succeeded in designing a synthesizer allowing for to control sounds from perceptual evocation. So I will show you now, and I will soon finish, don't worry, two short movies showing how the sound can be controlled by altering.
Just off the edge of any mouth, is that okay?
Yes, you can do whatever you want. But I cannot do that with PowerPoint, of course. This is magic. Okay, so let's start with the synthesis of the controlled synthesis of the object. So this is the interface. Don't forget that, you know, when you change sounds, you have to manipulate hundreds of parameters. And here, the challenge is to manipulate these hundreds parameters just by describing the sound you're waiting for. So here is an interface. The object is decomposed in mainly three parts: the material, the shape, and its size. And let's see how it works. So let's suppose that we want to make the sound produced by a wooden bar. I go to wood, to bar, I choose the size, and I make a sound which is a prototype of that. Let's now go to metal. This is a metallic bar. Now I can change the size. If I want to replace the bar by a plate, I just change the shape. If I want now to change the size of the plate, and now if I want to make the sound produced by impacting a small glass, I go to glass, shell, small object with a bit of resonance. And that's it. So here I just manipulate sound invariant. We can do the same with invariant corresponding to action. So here I play this movie. I stop it now. You recognize on the right the interface corresponding to the object. And now we have had a space corresponding to the action. So now we decide that the object is a plastic plate, and we just play on the action. And we will see that it's possible to play interactively. Okay, so this work is a result of a wonderful collaboration at the lab with Simon Conant, Etienne Touré, Mitsuko Aramaki, Olivier Derrien, Charles Gondre, and Solvi Estad. And some of them are here, so if you want to ask them some questions, they will be happy to answer. And now, it's really time to finish now. We would like to do the same, of course, on real sound. So how to do to modify, for example, to manipulate the object part of sound, real sound, or the action part of a real sound. So this is a question for mathematicians. I need help. So, of course, I talked with Bruno, who immediately jumped on this problem. And very recently, Bruno Torresani and his student, Harold Omer, who is somewhere here, ready to defend his PhD, got very nice results. And I show one of these results. So you can see on this picture the wavelet transform of the sound corresponding to an accelerating engine car. I play the sound. So the design technique allowing to extract from the sound the what they call the time warping function, to estimate this time warping function, which corresponds for me to the action, the accelerating action. And they also succeeded in removing from the sound this action, this time warping function, in order to get what they call the stationarized part of the sound. And for me, this is the object. So let's listen to the object. This is just an engine sound. And I really love this result, and it's very promising, and I hope we can collaborate on this, because you can understand now that it's possible to change, for example, the action, make the car accelerating, slowing down, and so on, or change the characteristic of the engine. But this is only, I think, the beginning of a new story. So thank you very much for your attention.